The Alamance County Cooperative Extension Service presents Selecting and Caring for Holiday Plants.
Hi, I'm Rhett Davis with the County Cooperative Extension Service here in Alamance County. This is a time of year that many homeowners go out and choose their own Christmas tree, one that's already been cut and is ready to go right into the house. But there's also homeowners that would like to have a tree that they could plant out in their yard rather than one they threw away after Christmas is over. We have several species of conifers or cone-bearing trees that do quite well in our area of North Carolina. We cannot grow the Fraser fir like they do up in the mountains and expect it to live here very long. Actually, it won't last more than about 2 or 3 years in our hot, dry summers. But we can choose from some of the spruces, such as white spruce, or even the Norway spruce. This is a Norway spruce right here that's been planted out now for about 4 years. The Norway spruce is a tree that will live here if planted in full sun, and over the years become a beautiful tall conifer that can complement many landscapes, especially if you have a lot of space. These trees will grow probably up to 50 to 70 feet tall eventually, so you need to give it a lot of room to grow. This tree is about 10 feet tall, but I do keep it sheared every year. So I keep it compact and I keep it tight looking. It makes a beautiful living Christmas tree that we put lights on and light this up in front of the agriculture building every Christmas. Other trees we can choose from are white pines that also grow in the mountains, but they will last over a short period of time here in the Piedmont. And you can also grow red cedars. Those basically are the species of trees, white spruce, Norway spruce, white pine, or the eastern red cedar that will do well here. Some homeowners also opt to get a Leyland cypress. Those trees can be bought as a live tree and used in the landscape and turn out to do very well here. But today we're looking at the Norway spruce. To me, this is the one that looks like our historical Christmas tree. It looks like the one we have in the house at Christmas time. This looks like the Fraser fir that so many of us fell in love with as a boy or girl. But the Norway spruce here is a beautiful tree, evergreen of course, and well adapted to our area. This tree will put out new growth in the spring, and that's the time that we shear them or we clip them back to keep them in this beautiful pyramidal shape. Now, when you go to the nursery or whether you go to a Christmas tree lot here in the county, you may be able to find a tree right now that's just been dug up in the mountains or either further west of here and brought in as a live tree. They'll come in referred to as a bald and burlap tree. They get the name from the root ball, which is bound in burlap. This is natural burlap. It will rot. And then it's tied together with nylon. This nylon cord here will not rot, so therefore it's going to have to be removed. But this is a bald and burlap tree, freshly dug, probably within the last week or so. And this can be used as a living or live Christmas tree in your home for a short period of time. The problem is the longer these trees are in your house, the more apt they're going to dry out. So we'd like to see you to put these live trees in some kind of container that can hold water. You can use a plastic one, rubber one, whatever, but it's going to have to be in a container like this so you can add some water to this root ball as it dries out in your house. Because you're going to put it in a house that's anywhere from 65 to 72 degrees and expect it to stay fresh and green over the next 3 to 4 weeks, and the whole time this tree's going to start needing water in its needles, the root ball begins to dry out. So you're going to have some way to add some water, yet it not go all over the floor. So you put this in a container like this, and maybe about once a week, add at least a gallon or two of water slowly over this. You're going to have to pull this burlap back and soak that root ball. We don't want the tree sitting in water. If that ever happens, you need to scoop a little bit of it out. But have some way to put it in a container like this. And you may want to pack the sides with sphagnum moss or some type of packing material so it doesn't wobble, and bring it in the house. Now, I often recommend to homeowners, when you buy a living tree, just go ahead and plant it in the yard the day you get it home, because its chances of survival are greatly enhanced by not putting it in the house for 4 or 5 weeks, but going directly to the landscape and getting it planted and start this tree being protected for the winter, because it will start to root over the winter. When you do take these home and you are going to plant them, whether it's after Christmas or right when you bring them home, you need to be reminded that this is artificial. This is nylon. It's going to have to be cut off. Now, I'm not going to cut this off now, but what I would do would be to cut this all this off and remove this nylon, unwrap it here, because this will not degrade. Once you've done that, now you've got burlap that's twisted on here, kind of like around a Tootsie Roll Pop. You begin to unwind it. What I would do would be to take a sharp knife and split it right here. Leave the burlap from here down. Leave the wire on it. The wire will hold the roots together. This will eventually rust away in the soil. The roots will grow around it. This presents no problem. This does. So once you get this in the ground, take your knife or scissors and cut it off here. Remove all the burlap from here so you see the fresh soil that's right here. And of course, your plant should not be planted any deeper than right here. So this new soil will come right up to the side here, and right here will be showing. Now I want to see this in the ground. I don't want dirt stacked upon it. I want to be able to see this soil level with my soil, or my soil that I have in my landscape right now. So once that is in, what you do, or get ready to plant the hole, get ahead of myself here, you want to dig a hole that's twice as wide as the root ball. So that root ball is probably a good 30 inches in diameter. So I'm going to come out here and I'll begin to dig a hole that goes at least twice as wide all the way around here. It doesn't need to be any deeper than the root ball. That root ball is probably good 14 to 16 inches deep, so my hole only needs to be 14 or 16 inches deep. If you dig it too deep, it will settle and cause a drainage problem. So dig the root ball no deeper than from right here to right here, but at least twice as wide. That allows the roots to grow out horizontally into the soil. Once you do that, got it in the soil, pack the soil back around it. No fertilizer at all goes in the hole. And then take some type of organic mulch. If you like pine needles, that's great. And you put 4, 5 to 6 inches of pine needles all over the root ball and all the way out, so it's protected, holds the moisture in, and this tree will get rooted over the winter time. And your chances of survival are greatly enhanced if you can get this tree planted either the day after Christmas or either the day you bring it home. But the Norway spruces and our other conifers that will grow here do make nice additions to your landscape. They make excellent screens. And if you'll treat it like we have this one here, you can actually keep it clipped and sheared and make it look like a living Christmas tree right there on your own property. Put lights on it, decorations. Put pine cones on it filled with suet or peanut butter for the birds. But your children, I think, mine did, love having a living Christmas tree outside. And we have several to choose from, but now is the time to go looking for them and to make your purchase. I'm the county horticulturist here, and a lot of times I get asked questions about what makes a great gift at Christmas time. And of course, plants are some of our best gifts because they can be used both indoors and later on, perhaps taken outdoors. And of course, at Christmas time, there's hardly any plant that beats the poinsettia. Poinsettias are native of Mexico, not of North America. The Aztecs actually raised these plants down there for centuries, and it wasn't until around 1820 that our ambassador to Mexico brought this plant back and introduced it to the United States. In fact, it's actually named after him. His name was Joel Poinsett. And from all the way in the 19th century and on into the 20th century, poinsettias have become a very popular plant to give at Christmas time. They're colorful, they come in over 100 different cultivars. And that means we have many different selections of different colors, from white bracts to ones that are striped, ones that are pink, and of course the all-time favorite is the red poinsettia. The poinsettia is a plant that begins to bloom when the days get short. In essence, when the nights get longer than the daytime, it sends a signal to the plant to begin to flower. A common misconception is that all this red foliage is actually flowers, but it's not. The flower of a poinsettia is very, very small. It's located right in the middle of these red bracts, as we call them,
which are just modified leaves, but the flowers are very small, and you can see one there. But these red bracts, which are beside the flower, is actually what encourages the bees and other pollinating insects to find the flower that's in the middle. And of course, the plant breeders over the last decades have developed different colors and more attractive poinsettias with darker green leaves against the bright red or the pinks or the yellows or even the whites, make very attractive and wonderful gifts at Christmas time. And we'll talk a little bit about the care of the poinsettia. It's a plant that obviously comes from a tropical area of North America, where it's been used to be growing outdoors in temperatures of 80 degrees and warmer. They cannot survive frost, so therefore cold weather, cold nights, cold rooms in the house would not be a desirable place to put them. You like to put them somewhere where there's very little draft, very little exposure to cold air, preferably somewhere in a window, somewhere it can get bright light. That keeps the colors rich and keeps them from fading. And you can put them, of course, on tables or on the floor. Now, when you put them on the floor, mamas and daddies get worried that this is a poisonous plant. For years, people thought this was a poisonous plant and still get concerned over pets eating them or children eating them. It is not considered a poisonous plant at all. So don't get alarmed by this, because I'm going to break a leaf off here and show you what most people worry about. As you'll see, the white latex sap that comes from the leaf of the poinsettia, and I'll put it against this dark green here, where perhaps you can see it. This is latex. It tells you that plant is in the spurge family. It's one of the euphorbs, and it produces this white latex. Some people worry about this being maybe somewhat poisonous, but it is not. Just think about all of the hundreds of thousands of florists and greenhouse growers that handle these plants every day on a daily basis and worry about this. But this is not a poisonous plant, neither to your pets nor to you. But of course, if you don't want your children chewing on them, if you got young children, it's always good advice to put them up so they don't get into any plant, because you don't just want them chewing on your ornamental plants. When you bring these home, they're often wrapped in very nice foil, red, green, or whatever it is. Even though it looks nice, I would recommend that you take this foil off, because this pot is designed to drain. And when it sits on a bench in the greenhouse, it's got to drain out when it gets too much water in it. But when you put a piece of foil under it, it will hold the water. Poinsettias do not like to be set in containers or anything where their feet or their roots stay wet. So we recommend taking this off when you get it at home, putting this either on a plate or some type of drainage dish, so the water, when you overwater, comes out and you can see when the plant's got enough water. This keeps the plant from standing in water and will certainly let the plant last for as long as 8 weeks. Now, in my home, we keep these until springtime. We keep them in a sunny window, even though they've passed their prime, and we'll put these out in the yard as a house plant after the threat of frost. I'll cut the plant back about 4 or 5 inches from the top of the pot and take this outside around the end of April, first week of May, put it in full sun and grow it as a beautiful foliage plant. I will not use it again in the house, because it will grow almost up to waist high in the garden, and it's just too much trouble to bring them back in the house, not to mention all the pests and things that might get on them in the summer. But they make very dependable outdoor foliage plants in the summer. But during the Christmas season, up until probably the middle of January, you should get weeks and weeks of wonderful color. I don't know of any greater plant for making arrangements and bringing striking color into the room than the poinsettias. And take a look at all the different cultivars. Florists will have several to choose from. Many of the big box stores in the county and some other greenhouses and nurseries will have many selections to choose from, even one called Jingle Bells. So take a look at them, look at the colors, and use them this year in your home for the festive occasions that you have at Christmas time and all the extra color it can provide you. A very simple plant to take care of, water it once a week, no fertilizer at all, and it's basically trouble-free and a welcome addition at Christmas time.
Well, I'm Rhett Davis, the County Extension Director here, and also the horticulturist. So if you have any questions on plant care, plant selection, and how to look after plants, you can certainly give me a call at 570-6740, or come by and see me at the Agricultural Building, 209 North Graham Hopedale Road in Burlington.